Good morning, everybody. Standing in line, waiting to go into court. As you're going to discover in just a moment or two, I do not represent the San Fernando Superior Court. Now, some of you are going into the courthouse today to stand before a judge, maybe for a parking ticket, or maybe for a more serious offense. Some of you are going to go into the courthouse today to serve as a member of the jury. It's going to be up to you to decide the innocence or the guilt of someone who is standing before the judge. I want you to consider another courtroom. There's another courtroom that each and every one of us are going to stand before one day. The Bible says it's appointed once for a person to die, and after that comes the judgment. We are all part of the ultimate statistic. 10 out of 10 people die. And when we die, we're all going to stand before Almighty God, and He is going to judge us. Now, most of you probably think that, well, I'm not really worried about that because God's going to weigh my good against the bad. He's going to consider me to be a good person because that's how I think of myself. And so He's going to just overlook all the crimes I've committed against Him and just let me into heaven. But that's not the case, folks. God is not arbitrary in His judgment. He does not grade on a curve. Because He is holy and righteous and just, He must judge in equity. He must judge in righteousness. And He has provided only one standard by which He will judge each and every one of us, and that's the standard of His perfect, holy law. And we have a summary of that law in the Ten Commandments. So what I would ask you to do this morning is, instead of looking in the mirror of your own goodness to see how you'll do on the day of judgment, I would ask that you would look into the mirror of God's holy law to see how you would do. Now, folks, when you stand before God, He is going to judge you, again, according to the perfect moral standard of His law. So ask yourself and answer these following questions. Have you ever told a lie, even one lie? Well, if you've told a lie, God does not see you as a good person. He sees you as a liar. Think of it this way. If I lied to one of my children, it would be wrong, but I would probably suffer no consequences. If I lied to my wife, I might end up sleeping on the couch. If I lie to my boss, I could lose my job. If I lie in court, I might end up going to jail. It's the same offense, but the consequences are different based upon whom the offense is against. God is infinitely holy and righteous and just. Therefore, any sin against God, no matter how small we make it in our mind, is infinitely sinful to an infinitely holy God. Have you ever stolen anything? It doesn't matter how small or how long ago. If you've stolen something, God does not see you as a good person. He sees you as a thief. Have you ever taken God's name in vain, used His name to express disgust or excitement? Well, then He doesn't see you as a good person. He sees you as one who blasphemes His name. And the word of God is true. The Lord will not leave him unpunished who takes His name in vain. Have you ever looked at another person and had a sexual desire, someone other than a spouse? Well, then according to God's standard, you're not a good person. You're an adulterer at heart. Jesus said whoever looks at a person to lust after them, has already committed adultery with that person in their heart. Now, how about this one? Have you ever murdered anybody? Most of you probably would say that you've never murdered anybody. You probably have never driven a knife in someone's back. But if you've ever harbored bitterness against someone, if you've ever harbored resentment, if you've ever hated anybody, never did anything about it, but even thought about it in your mind, God considers you to be a murderer. The Word of God says whoever hates another person is a murderer. You see, God's standard is perfection. That's what God demands of each of us. Now, I would be the first to say that I cannot live up to that standard. None of us can. But God does not lower His standard simply because we are unable to live up to it. And because God is holy and righteous and just, if you die today and stand before Him, and judges you according to the standard of His law, He must punish sin. And the punishment God has described for sin is eternity in hell. And it doesn't matter whether or not we believe it. What matters is whether or not it's true. And the time to find out if it is in fact true is not when you're standing before God waiting to be judged. That would be like going in the courtroom today and saying, Your Honor, I didn't think I'd get caught. I didn't think the jury would find me guilty, and I didn't think you would punish me, so I think you ought to just let me go. A good judge is going to say, you should have thought about that before you broke the law. And the same will be true if you try to make that argument when you stand before the supreme judge of the universe. He will say, depart from me, I never knew you. You continually broke my law. And folks, that is bad news. But before the good news will make any sense to you at all, I have to share the bad news with you. The good news is this. 2,000 years ago, God the Father sent his Son to earth, Jesus Christ, fully God and fully man and without sin. He was born of a virgin, just as the prophet said he would be, 750 years before his birth. Unlike you and me, he never once transgressed the law of God in thought, word, or deed. He was perfect in every respect. He was the God-man. He was God in the flesh. And about 30 to 33 years into his earthly existence, he voluntarily went to the cross. He died a horrible, bloody death on the cross, taking upon himself the punishment you rightly deserve for breaking God's law in thought, word, or deed. And then 3 days later, he rose from the dead, and he forever defeated death. He is alive today, and he will return at a time of the Father's choosing. Jesus' first sermon was simple, but all important. He said, you must repent and believe in the gospel. What God commands of all people everywhere, because he has fixed the day in which he will judge the world in righteousness, is that each and every one of us repent. Repentance means more than just going into the courtroom and saying, Judge, I'm really sorry that I got caught, so I think you ought to forgive me and let me go. No, repentance is a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of direction. It is a forsaking of your sin. Instead of loving your sin and drinking it up like water, instead of enjoying your sin and creating a God in your own imagination that will not judge your sin, you would instead repent of your sin, turn from it, and beg Almighty God for forgiveness. And what God requires of you is that you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. Now, some of you might have gone to church where someone told you, hey, just pray this prayer and accept Jesus into your heart. I've got news for you. Jesus Christ does not need your acceptance. He needs nothing from you. You need his acceptance. And you can only receive that if God causes you to be born again. Jesus said, unless a man is born again, he will not see the kingdom of God. And you can no more cause yourself to be born spiritually than you can cause yourself to be born physically. And if God, through his infinite love and grace and mercy and kindness, causes you to be born again, then the result will be that you will repent of your sin. You will turn from your sin. And by faith alone, you will receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. Do you understand what God did? God allowed his one and only Son to die on the cross, and he literally poured out all of his judgment, all of his justice, all of his holy wrath upon the perfect sinless life of his one and only Son. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Do you understand what God did? He allowed his precious Son to die a horrible, bloody death on the cross for those who would repent and believe the gospel. It is not by coincidence that you're standing in this very long line this morning. It's not by coincidence that some of you are waiting to step into the courtroom to be judged by a human judge. And again, it's appointed once for a person to die, and after that comes the judgment.